Hi, I'm Dr. Simone Webber from Creating Tomorrow's Forests, and in this video in our lake construction series, I will be chatting with our founder, Nick, to discuss biodiversity on site. We will take a look at the methods we're currently using to assess biodiversity uplift and our future plans for biodiversity monitoring, plus much, much more, so stay tuned.
I know we've talked about biodiversity a lot on this, and people have had their questions, you know, is it a fishing lake? Is it a biodiversity lake? How can it be a biodiversity lake if there's fish in it? But how are we monitoring the biodiversity? You're the doctor of ecology.
Biodiversity is my thing. So what you do when you monitor, there's a ton of different metrics for monitoring biodiversity. There's different ways of doing it, but the way we're doing it here is we've taken a baseline, partly using sort of a traditional ecology survey, which we had done before you started, as part of the planning process, before you started the lake dig. We're also using the DEFRA biodiversity metric, which is part of the new biodiversity net gain system that's coming in. But we've also taken a baseline with eDNA. So we took, obviously we couldn't take a baseline before we had the lake because there was no water there. But we took a water baseline sort of very early on, just as it was filling up.
What's eDNA?
eDNA. So eDNA, essentially, you can take a water sample or a soil sample. You run it through what's called a metabarcoding process, and it's very clever. It compares the DNA, the trace DNA that's found in the sample, against a sort of database of different species, and then you get a list of species come out, or not necessarily down to species level always if it's invertebrates, but it gives you sort of down to family level, so you can see the diversity of species that you've got. So what we've found here, there was shortly after we'd started, there were 10 vertebrate species being detected here. Palmate newt was one of them. Duck species, it was teal that were being picked up, and also Canada geese, which are always kicking around. And then invertebrate species, we had 78. So a lot of them were the Daphnia that you'd seeded the lake with, the copepods. We didn't have any dragonfly nymph DNA at that point, but I'm sure if you did it now, there'd be dragonfly nymph DNA. So what we're going to do is next spring, we'll take another sample at that point when the lake is like really busy with amphibians and invertebrates. We'll take another sample then and compare and see how it's changed over time.
Hey everyone, if you're enjoying our journey in creating this beautiful lake, please don't forget to hit the like button. Your support really does help our channel grow. If you haven't subscribed yet, now's the perfect time. Make sure to turn on the notification bell so you don't miss out on any of our upcoming videos. We've got loads of exciting content coming up, including our tree planting adventures up and down the country, and we're currently running several biodiversity projects. Remember, every like, comment and share helps us bring awareness to these vital environmental initiatives. Thanks for being part of the community, and I hope you enjoy the rest of the video. It's quite exciting, this point, right? Because you're seeing hockey stick graphs at the moment, which is really nice.
Yeah.
But at some point, that will start to level off, we think.
Yeah, you should reach a sort of, I mean, you don't ever reach a sort of like a stable state. You know, it's an ecosystem. It's never sort of in a stable state. But you will reach a point where, it'll sort of like, you'll get your biodiversity uplift. What we're predicting for the lake is a 265% uplift in biodiversity based on the DEFRA biodiversity metric, because our freshwater habitats we've lost so many freshwater habitats, and they're so polluted and in such bad condition across the country that lakes are one of the real priority habitats to be creating. So we're predicting a big uptick in biodiversity for this compared to what it was before, which was just sort of, you know, marginal grazing.
Pretty standard.
Yeah, rubbish kind of, you know, grazing pasture. This one's just going.
Inbound.
Oh, it's coming straight at us. So we're predicting a big biodiversity uplift for the lake. And as I said, we will keep monitoring that with eDNA. We'll keep monitoring it with, we've got camera traps that are going out to look for, you know, mammals that are going past. We're going to come out next year. We'll do some bat surveying. We'll do some, we're always looking, keeping an eye out for birds. Other things we're going to be doing here is managing the hedges in a very particular way, because it's a brown hair streak butterfly priority area, so they want uncut blackthorn hedges, so we'll be looking at that as well. And we'll just keep monitoring all these things and build up this picture over time of how the lake has contributed to increase in biodiversity.
I think one of the comments that we had recently was someone questioning the carbon emissions and what it cost us to create this, and how long is it worth it to do it with the carbon we burn to kind of make it. And it was quite an interesting exercise, wasn't it?
It was an interesting exercise to work it out. And I think we came up with a figure, was it 237 tons, I think, wasn't it? And that's based on the sort of the fuel emissions of the diggers, but also any time you disturb the soil, you're releasing carbon. So even if you're planting a tree, you are actually releasing a little bit of carbon every time you do that. So this was quite a big work in terms of sort of moving soil around. So we did some estimates. Yeah, we came up with 237 tons of carbon emitted. And we calculated out that between the 5,000 trees that we planted and the lake itself, and all the aquatic marginal plants, it'll offset it within about 3.5 years, because the lake is storing carbon all the time, especially in the sediment. I can see loads of sediment from where I'm stood. So all these plants, all these aquatic marginals are creating, trapping sediment in their roots, and that's where the carbon's stored. So yeah, it won't take long for it to offset that carbon, and then it will start being a carbon sink. So it'll start absorbing more and more carbon than the land would have done before. So
I think the calculations came out that in a couple of years we'll be uptaking 24 tons per year.
Yeah.
Positive for a project.
Yeah, that's right. I think it was more than that, actually. I think the lake itself is 24 tons, and then the trees are 42 tons.
Oh, right, okay, so it's even better than that.
Yeah.
That's amazing.
Yeah, the trees are absorbing quite, because there's quite a lot of trees here. It doesn't look like it, but there's quite a lot of trees here, and they're absorbing quite a lot as well, so.
You don't really think of lakes as being a carbon sink. Oh, I personally didn't think of it as being a carbon storage mechanism, and it's quite effective, isn't it?
Yeah, it's not as effective, it's not as fast as trees. I think trees are the quickest way of storing carbon, but other habitats, you know, certainly in the soil, so a really diverse meadow stores a lot more in the soil than a woodland would. But it's, as I said, it's all in the sediment, so reed beds are fantastic, and it's not just carbon they're storing, they are storing nutrients as well, so they're preventing eutrophication. All the excess nutrients that are currently in the soil will sort of leach off into the and get trapped in the sediment around the reeds. So that's why reeds are really good for nutrient neutrality projects and things like that.
That's incredible, really. With the amount of lakes in the country, and especially angling clubs, I guess like managing them in a more diverse way is really crucial, not only to the habitat and the local biodiversity, but also is contributing to the carbon problem.
It's all tied in together. So the more biodiversity you have, the more carbon you store, the more, you know, habitat you create for wildlife. We just need to look at things in a more sort of holistic way, I think, and examine everything together. And that's something we will be monitoring in the lake, as well as water quality, because that's quite easy to do. And, you know, we can look at the sort of improvement in water quality over time.
For more information about our projects and to get involved, head over to www.creatingtomorrowsforest.co.uk.
If you found this video helpful, don't forget to like this video, leave a comment below, and subscribe to our channel.